Very good afternoon to all of you. For those of you who are not in Bangalore, after almost 6 months, we had rains. But that's one rain. I don't know how long it will last. The people who are creating havoc with the environment and ecology, they don't seem to feel guilty about it at all. The way things are moving, the way, you know, urbanization, concrete jungles are being built up in cities. Nobody seems to be bothered what is going to be the long-term effect. Nobody seems to be guilty that we are making so much money at the cost of playing around with nature and making life miserable for, you know, the citizens, the ordinary common people who are suffering so much. Anyway, that's a different topic. We'll talk about it some other day. Today, let me start off with repeating what most of you already know, and that is that there are innumerable emotions. As our thoughts go, the emotions follow. When I think of something nice, I feel serene, I feel happy, I feel contented. Suddenly, I think of something bad that has happened or is happening or is likely to happen. Then I feel sad, I feel angry, I feel disappointed. So like that, there's a stream of emotions. And many emotions are very sort of soft. They don't really affect our life so much. But there are certain emotions which can play havoc with our life. Again, as you very well know, it is emotions that govern our actions. What we say or what we do depends on what we are feeling at that moment. Our emotions change and our words, our actions change accordingly. So let us be very much aware that it is emotions that govern our life. Now, there are so many emotions. There are combinations of emotions. There are what people call good emotions and bad emotions. I don't say so. I think all emotions are neutral. Because emotions come from within. They are not in your control. Whatever your thoughts automatically lead to certain emotions. So how can emotions be good or bad? It's like saying hunger is bad, or being sleepy is bad, or feeling cold is bad. No, you don't choose to become hungry or sleepy or feel cold, isn't it? So the same way as physical feelings cannot be defined as good or bad, mental feelings, that is emotions also, cannot be defined as good or bad. Sometimes fear is good for you because then you'll take precautions. Sometimes anger is good for you because based on that anger, you get work done, you become more, you know, vociferous in achieving what you want to do. The same way, happiness cannot be defined as a good emotion because somebody who is happy can be so self-centered that he neglects everybody else and he just pampers his ego to be happy. So the same way, I am a firm believer that there is no such thing as, you know, good emotions and bad emotions. We are also aware that the emotions which are mostly considered to be the core emotions are happiness, sadness, fear, and anger. Today we are not going to talk about any of those. We are going to talk about a different emotion, which is guilt. I give a lot of importance to guilt. Whenever I'm counseling somebody, when I'm talking about how they are feeling or whatever it is, if they've gone through a bad time or if they've had certain setbacks or if they are not in a good frame of mind, I gently take my counselee to the point where I ask, are you feeling guilty about anything? And I give the person even time to think. You don't have to tell me right now. When we meet next, spend some time thinking over and then let me know if you feel that, yes, there is a certain amount of guilt, we need to work on it. Because as long as guilt exists in my mind, I cannot perform, I cannot relate, and I cannot achieve anywhere close to my competency or my desire or my capability. So guilt is one emotion which I give a lot of importance to. And whenever guilt comes into somebody, we need to be aware that that person is not going to be performing well or relating properly to people. And that is why I took up this topic. Okay, so in a very general manner, first let us define what guilt is. Guilt is defined as a feeling of responsibility or even remorse for some offense or crime or something wrong that I have done, which is real or imagined. Make a note of that. You have done something wrong and you can feel guilty. You may not have done something wrong and you can still feel guilty. That's the beauty of it. There are people who are so egoistic, so within themselves, so full of their own glory and their achievements that they never feel guilty. Because they say, I can never do wrong. Whatever I do is the right thing to do. You remember that old dialogue of Amitabh Bachchan? There's a big queue for food and Amitabh bypasses the queue and goes to collect his food, and the other people say, ke bhaiya queue mein aao. So in his grand style, he says, hum jahan khade hote hain, line wahan se shuru hoti hai. This is a classic example of a person who is so full of himself, so confident about himself, that he does not even think that he may be doing some harm, either to himself or to other people around him. So there are a few people around us, I'm sure each one of you knows somebody or a few people like that, who never feel guilty, who say, I never do anything wrong, so why should I feel guilty? On the other hand, the beauty of it is that there are many more people around you who feel guilty even without having done anything wrong. So when I have not done something wrong, why should I feel guilty? Why should I have that remorse? Why should I have a regret about whatever I have done or I am doing? That is what I want to discuss with you all today. Okay. The important thing is that guilt can cause a lot of self-destruction. Guilt actually pulls down my self-esteem. If I suffer from guilt on a repetitive way, every now and then I think and I feel I've done something wrong. I should not have done this. I should have done that in a better manner. I should have done this thing earlier than what I did. I did it too late, or I did something too early that was not the right thing to do. I think I have hurt somebody by my actions, even though that person is not saying that I have hurt them, but I feel that I have hurt somebody. Whenever these things happen, I start feeling this emotion called guilt. And when I feel guilty, I look upon myself as an incompetent person, as a person who does wrong things, as a person who is not a very nice person. And when I do that, my self-worth, my self-esteem goes down. So tomorrow, even when I can do something good, I don't even attempt it. Why? Because I say that no, I'm not capable of doing it. I may make a mistake. I may land up by doing something wrong. So let me not take a chance. Let me not even attempt something which in the normal course I was confident of being able to do. this is how things go wrong. The other thing that happens is, if I feel guilty, I start telling other people. People may not even have noticed what I did or what I'm doing, but I make it a point to tell them, you know, I made such a horrible mistake. You know, I did such a wrong thing. You know, I think I have hurt somebody by my words or my actions. Now, the more I keep repeating that, the more people start believing that I'm not a good human being. I don't do good things. I do bad things. And when that happens, people don't look upon me nicely. And when people don't look upon me nicely, it gets reinforced to my mind that, see, what I said was right. I'm not a good person. I do wrong things. And I get into that vicious cycle. The more I keep feeling guilty, the more I start labeling that I have done A, B, C, D wrong things. And the more I identify myself with the wrong things, the lower is my self-worth, the lower I think is my competency, and eventually the lower is my self-esteem. I start believing that I am no good. I start telling other people I am no good. I stop attempting to do good even when I know that I can do it. And along with that, firstly, my motivation goes down. Secondly, I start punishing myself. I come across so many people who punish themselves, who hurt themselves, sometimes physically, but mostly emotionally. I don't deserve to get good food. I don't deserve this holiday. I don't deserve to have good friends. I don't deserve to make good money. I'm not deserving enough for anybody to be nice to me. And if somebody is being nice to me, they are doing it out of pity because I'm such a worthless fellow, no? So they have this sympathy and pity over me, and that is why they are being nice to me. Not because I deserve to be treated nicely. See how I am going deeper and deeper into these things. And as I said, I start depriving myself of things which I deserve and desire. That is the destructive value of suffering from repeated guilt. Okay, here let me make one thing clear. Once in a while, everybody feels guilt. We actually do something wrong, or we neglect something, or you know, we don't pay sufficient attention to something, and we get that regret and we say, no, I am guilty of this thing. Nothing wrong with that. In fact, like any other emotion, an emotion can actually be used to improve yourself. So once in a while, if you feel guilty that I didn't take care of my friend or my father, I didn't perform as well as I should have, though I'm getting a good salary, I didn't study hard enough for my exam. When that happens, when that guilt happens, it spurs me on to do better next time. But like I said, if I get caught in that vicious cycle of feeling guilty about anything and everything, then my performance, my relationships, my self-esteem, everything goes down. Now the question is, why should I feel guilty at all? I've done something to the best of my ability, what I felt right at that time I did it, or I am doing it right now. So why should I even feel guilty? One reason is I feel that I have violated moral standards. I have done something which is immoral or unethical. That is one very common area of a person to feel guilty. And the way we are imbibed into our morals, that this is good, this is bad. This should be done and this should not be done. And the moment I do something against what morals have taught me, and if I am a sensitive person, I automatically start feeling guilty. The other reason why I feel guilty is when I think that I have hurt somebody, knowingly or unknowingly, but I have hurt somebody. And if that person tells me that you have hurt me, at least it makes some sense. Yes, that person actually told me. But the beauty of it is, very often, that person is happy. That person is not complaining. That person is not saying that you have done anything wrong to me. But I have made up my mind that I have hurt that person. So even if it is not true, I decide that I have hurt somebody. I have let down somebody. I have been bad to somebody. And with that, I start thinking that I am guilty of this offense. Okay. Now, if you are experiencing any of those, or you want to help somebody who is experiencing this form of guilt, then you need to work towards overcoming the guilt that is making you think that way. You have to start with your thinking process. You have to start with setting right your wrong thoughts, irrational thoughts, not logical, but fantasy thoughts. So you have to start at the thought process, and then only your emotion called guilt reduces. At this point, let me also differentiate and tell you that guilt and shame are not the same. Shame is when I think that other people are looking down upon me, or actually people are looking down upon me. If people tell me, shame on you, you didn't study and you got only 60%, you could have got 90%. Or shame on you, your cousin needed money and you didn't give him that money. Hey, Baba, I didn't have the money, I have my own liabilities. No, he's your own cousin brother, you should have given it to him. So you see what happens? Very often people imbibe that thing in us, and that borders more on shame than on guilt. They're very closely connected, but they're not the same. Guilt, as I told you earlier also, can be with nobody pointing fingers at me. Everybody is happy. Everybody says I'm a nice person. I always do good things. But somewhere, if my self-esteem is low, if I'm questioning myself all the time, I tend to fall into the trap of guilt. And if even there is one important person in my life who imbibes that guilt into me, then I am caught in that web. A couple of our teammates, youngsters, they did a small little skit, to show how guilt can be imbibed by another person. When I am not feeling guilty, how I can be made to feel guilty. Here it is. Anis is putting on that video.
Okay, he won't go anywhere. Bye. Oh my God, you know the guy who was texting me yesterday? He said he wants to meet. You sound like you're jealous.
Dude, you just met him yesterday.
So? You're just jealous that he didn't text you first. This has been happening.
Excuse me.
You just can't stand the fact that I'm prettier than you, or guys can like me more than you.
I'm just looking out for
you. I don't care what you have to say. I am going to go out with him.
Whatever you want.
She could have easily lied about me, but she did not, even after I screamed at her so much. I shouldn't have screamed at her so much.
Very small incident, but just to shake you up and make you think how guilt can be imbibed by other people. So I would ask you, if you are a sensitive person, to please keep away from people who have this tendency of passing the buck on to you, wanting to defend themselves by putting somebody else down, by commenting on somebody else, or thinking badly about somebody else. By doing that, you become the victim. And the more you are in the company of such people who make you feel guilty, sometimes they can be very close people. It could be a parent, it could be a spouse, it could be a child. If you allow others to make you feel guilty and simultaneously you are surrounded by people who have this habit, like I mentioned, of passing the buck to you and putting blame on you for something which you are not blameworthy, when that happens, you start going down in that spiral. So I request you to identify people around you, either people who are very important to you, like your inner circle, or people with whom you have to interact on a regular basis. If anybody falling into either of these categories makes it a habit, for no rhyme or reason, pointing out at your mistakes, pointing out to your shortcomings, and being very vocal about it. How could you have done such a silly thing? Why did you not do this thing? You could have done that, no? How is it that you didn't even bother to do such a thing? Or why did you hurt that person? I'm sure that person is feeling hurt by the way you behaved. The moment you start hearing such statements, please become aware. And if possible, keep away from such people. Because being sensitive people, being caring people, being compassionate people, we take these comments for granted. We take these comments very seriously. And we think that if such and such person is saying it, then it must be true. And the other thing that happens, as you know, a lie which is repeated 100 times becomes the truth. So here you have this person who's close to you or with whom you're interacting on a regular basis, and that person keeps repeating like a gramophone record that, you know, blame on you, keeps being critical about anything and everything that you are doing, constantly pointing out to your shortcomings. Initially you may say, no, I don't think that is true. I know what I'm doing is right. But when you hear it 100 times, it is human nature that you actually start believing it. And the moment you start believing it, and you start feeling guilty, everything goes off. So this guilt, according to me, is one of the very, very destructive emotions. I told you, guilt by itself is not bad. If you have a little bit of guilt here and there, even without anybody telling you, I should have been a little more sensitive to this friend of mine. I should not have made that comment about somebody. I should not have neglected the responsibility that was given to me. And if I feel guilty about it, nothing wrong. But that should happen only once in a while. If you find that it is happening quite often, or if you know somebody who's going through these type of, you know, incidents and phases on a repetitive basis, please take action. Please try to rationalize the feelings. One of the ways, of course, is to get somebody else to give you an opinion. When you have somebody else who knows you well enough and at the same time is objective, neither trying to flatter you nor trying to put you down, ask the opinion of that person. I was told by somebody that this is what I'm doing wrong. What do you feel about it? When that person says, no, I don't think you're doing anything wrong, then you have something to balance it out. Same way, take a notebook or your notepad in your phone and write it down. I was made to feel guilty because I did this, this, this. Keep it away. Open it a few days later and review. Have I really done something wrong? Do I really feel that I should be guilty because of this? If your conscience says no, then like I said, keep away from these people who keep putting you down. Be more in the company of rational and logical people who are frank with you, who neither flatter you nor put you down. And do the same rationalizing and logical thinking for your own self. If you can do that, I can tell you, you can overcome this, even if you have been suffering from it. Before I wind up, let me also tell you one or two, you know, forms of guilt, which can be very debilitating. One is what is known as survivor guilt. Let's say I have a sibling, I have a relative who is younger than me, and that person passes away. I can go into survivor guilt. I am older than this person. If somebody had to die, it should have been me, not this person who's younger than me. Yet, that person is gone and I'm still alive. I'm a survivor. I've seen this thing happening to people when they are traveling on the highway. An accident takes place. Somebody sitting next to that person dies or has a major, you know, fracture or disability, and for whatever the reason for which I was neither responsible nor I had anything to do with it, I come out without any hurt. Now that again leads me to survivor's guilt. This is something that we need to work on as and when it appears. Equally important is what we call as caretaker's guilt. I have some elderly person in the family or in my office or wherever. Now I become a sort of caretaker. I try to help that person. But if I am, again, like I told you, surrounded by people who are putting up high standards, and they say, you are not looking after that person as much as you should have. You are not taking as much care as you should be taking. Now who is the right person to measure this care that I'm giving? Definitely not that outsider or neutral person or a person who's not taking care of this person. But when they do say it, I get shaken up. And I start thinking that, yes, I haven't done enough. Here I am voluntarily being a caretaker for somebody. But if I believe that I should have taken more care, I should have spent more time, I should have taken that person to A hospital instead of B hospital, I start suffering from caretaker's guilt. These are just a couple of them that I wanted to share with you. There are many, many more. But the bottom line is that you should rationalize. You should think logically. You should be answerable only to your conscience. And if necessary, take opinion from neutral persons. You can overcome the guilt. So that's my message for you today. We have Meera to update you on what's going on here quickly. And then I'll be back in just a short while.
Good afternoon, everyone, and I hope everyone is having a great summer holiday. Of course, we are having some showers, and then again, it's getting hot, but I hope everybody is fine And like Ali was talking about guilt, many a times we need to address it, because sometimes it just becomes a part of our life, right? We just keep feeling guilty and we don't know what to do about it, and then it keeps getting suppressed. So at that point in time, like how Ali was saying, that you know, you need to talk to a trusted adult, or you need to talk to somebody who's not going to judge you, or somebody who's going to listen to you so nicely, or somebody's going to tell you that, you know what, it's okay, you know, let's work around it. And many a times guilt just happens because sometimes we feel guilty for not feeling guilty also, isn't it? So many a times, to understand what we are feeling also, we can talk. So at Banjara, we have free counseling through phone, through face-to-face, or anyhow, you can mail us, you can message us. Anyhow, we have free counseling. So please come. We have an amazing bunch of counselors who are here and who are willing to take you through in confidentiality and being non-judgmental, and they will listen more than anything, listening. Okay. And then you can also work out how you can navigate your path through this emotion. But sometimes what happens is that, you know, we feel that I'm listening, I'm taking this person forward. So many friends of mine are, you know, I'm their confidant. I listen to them, I talk to them, I give them a shoulder to cry on and all of that. So for those people, we have the DCS, okay? So you can walk by into our office or call us or even ask for the prospectus. And the course is starting soon and we are fast filling. So, you know, you can always come and talk to us and ask us. And sometimes it really helps to understand these things at depth, because that might also be like the purpose that you are going to be going on. So you can come to us and find out about DCS, that is a Diploma in Counseling Skills. Here, not only do we address emotions like guilt and regret, but we address almost everything from 0 to 99 years, all human emotions on that. So that is your DCS. And of course, it's no theory, no exams, practical hands-on experiential course. And the other thing is a small surprise, or a big surprise, whatever you want to take it as, that Ali is coming up with a mindfulness workshop. And actually, I have no details. Nobody has any details, only he has it. But we are all eagerly waiting, including me, to see what this holds, because that's the need of the hour. We need to be mindful. So looking forward to that, and stay tuned, because lots of more details on that coming, because I am looking forward to it. And I hope you guys also are doing so. Thank you. Have a great afternoon and a great weekend.
Yes, I'm back. And I can already see quite a few comments and questions. Let's take them up one by one. Sridevi says, have always wondered why some people resort to degrading others based on their fears. That's a good one, Sridevi. Based on their fears, right? Okay. It's important to ask ourselves if there is any real benefit to this behavior. In reality, belittling others only serves to perpetuate negativity and divide people further. Instead, let's focus on understanding and empathizing with one another, even when we may not agree on everything. By doing so, we can build bridges and promote a positive society. Excellent words, Sridevi, and I really wish more and more and more people follow this simple, the formula that you have pointed out. But let's also accept that everybody is not going to follow the same. We will have people around us, as you said, who resort to degrading others. And you brought out a very good point, based on their fears. There are people who take advantage of other people's fears, uncertainties, confusion, lack of confidence. And when they are in a vulnerable position, they drill it into them that this is where you have gone wrong. This is what you are doing, you know, not the way you should be doing. How dare you do such things? Aren't you ashamed of yourself? How can you be so insensitive to others? Very common statements. Very easy to degrade, to pass comments, to put down people. Now, why those people do it, there can be 100 different reasons. Today, we are not going to psychoanalyze those who do the degrading. We are interested in those who suffer. Whether it is you or somebody known to you, if you can help that person to work out how to minimize the effect of these people who create that negativity, we can do wonders. Vinita says, sometimes, Ali, we feel guilty at times due to our own morals, values, principles when we say no to someone or we are not able to do something though we wanted to do. Yes. Vinita and all you others, I have always asked you to differentiate between morals, values and principles and ethics. Morals is that which is handed down to us by our faith, our religion, our scriptures, our gurus, or even our elders. That is what morals is all about. It may have any logic, it may have no logic. You cannot have breakfast till you have a bath or till you do your puja. There is no scientific thing to say that what you are doing is wrong. But if that is what some elders or some scriptures believe in, and you do that, you have your breakfast without having a bath, you feel very guilty. That is because you are facing morals. On the other hand, values and principles are things that we believe in. I believe that these are my values and principles. For example, some people are vegetarians because their family, their scripture, their religion, or their elders have told them that you cannot eat non-veg food. Some people are vegetarians because they think it is cruelty to kill animals and eat their flesh. The first one is morals. The second one is values and principles. Let me add on another word which Vinita has not mentioned here. That is ethics. Ethics is when you are likely to harm somebody. When I think this is unethical. I have seen something belonging to somebody else. That person won't know if I take it away from them. The person may also be so rich that it's not really going to affect them. But if I pick up that thing and walk off with it, what I am doing is unethical. I am not being true. Here, unethical is in the category of values of giving, as compared to the other values, which are values of being. Values of giving are far more important. If you do something which goes against it, it is unethical. Whether the other person becomes aware of it, whether the other person blames you for it or not, but you have done something which has caused harm to the other person, so it comes under the category of being unethical. Now, this is what Vinita has said. Sometimes we feel guilty when we say no to someone or we're not able to do something though we want it to be. And here, remember, there are a lot of people to take advantage. Somebody will come to you and say, lend me 1,000 rupees. And you say, no, I don't want to. And you feel guilty. Do you owe money to him? No, not at all. He is asking you for a loan and you don't want to give him a loan. Is there any reason for you to feel guilty? No. Yet, there are so many people who feel guilty, or interesting thing is, they are made to feel guilty by that other person saying, what boss, you don't trust me with 1,000 rupees also. You know that I need that money badly. how much I'm going to suffer, and you have got your own so-called values and all that, and you say, no, I don't lend money. How cruel you can be. I am cruel. I have only said no to his, you know, asking for a loan. And the interesting thing is, when you go back to recover that loan, that person will say, no, I don't have the money. Why are you being so stingy? Why are you chasing me for that loan? Do you think I'm running away with that money? I'll give it to you later. May I need that money now. So what if you need? I need it even more. Whose money are we talking about? We're talking about your money. It's your right. But even in such situations, people make you feel guilty. So be aware of that. Okay. Vinita also says, sometimes Ali, we feel guilty at times due to... Yeah, that's what I just answered, no? Yeah. Suman says, how do you deal with a very close family person? Someone whom you see every day. Instilling guilt in you and in every action. There are different ways you need to try out and see which is most suitable under those circumstances and for that particular person. The first one I would say is to talk it over with that person. You are pointing fingers at this, this, this. I don't think that is right. I don't believe that. I think what I'm doing is right. I'm answerable to my conscience and I'm clear about it. So I would be thankful if you don't keep pointing that out as though I'm doing something wrong. I'm convinced that there is nothing wrong in what I'm doing. Some people will back off. Some people will not back off. They will use some reason, some logic to tell you, no, 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 how can you do that? That person is so poor. That person is so old. That person needs this. How can you not give this to them? How can you refuse me when I'm asking you for such a small thing? If that person insists on it, you take time off, be by yourself in solitude, take a piece of paper and write down what that person is saying to induce that guilt in you. Keep it. The next day or after 2 days, read it again. If you are clear, your conscience says, I think what I'm doing is right. I don't think I'm answerable and I don't think I need to feel guilty about these actions. Then you learn assertiveness. Next time that person says something, be assertive. Look that person straight in the eye and say, that's your opinion. I don't agree with it. We'll talk about it some other time and move out. The more you learn to do that, slowly you will notice that your guilt is coming down. And I also told you the other thing. Take an opinion from another neutral person. He's not the only person who's close to you or whom you have to meet every day. Find out somebody else who's also close to you or whom you interact with every day. And say, do you think I'm doing something unethical? Do you think I'm doing things which I need to be guilty about? If that person says no, I think what you're doing is perfectly right. Reinforce that to you. Maybe again, write it down and say, X is putting me down, but Y has reaffirmed to me that what I'm doing, there's nothing wrong with it. And also my conscience says that there is nothing wrong with it. It takes a little bit of practice. Takes a little bit of repetition. Like I told you, a lie told 100 times becomes the truth. The same way you have to reverse it by telling yourself 100 times, I am not doing anything wrong. Okay, Mamta says, yes, Ali, you had discussed about morals, principles and values in DCS sessions. Now, even more clearly explained, and if our ethics synchronize with our life principles or way of our life, we can minimize the feelings of guilt in some situations. Very true, Mamta. You're absolutely right. We can do that. If, as Mamta has rightly pointed out, synchronize with our life principles or the way our life is going, then you know that you're on the right track. And the more you keep doing it, the easier it becomes. Let me also caution you that the first time you are trying to rationalize and trying to overcome and undo what that person is trying to do to you, it is difficult. It is painful. You feel no Maybe I am being too rigid. Maybe I am being cruel. Maybe I am being insensitive. Let those thoughts come to you. It doesn't matter. You say, I'll try it out again. I'll practice it and see how it goes. Do it 1, 2, 3, 10 times. And slowly the guilt reduces. The pain reduces. The doubts which are there in your mind, am I doing something wrong? Am I hurting somebody? Am I doing something which I should not be doing? All these things start coming into your mind. So it is a slow process, like anything else to do with behavioral sciences. In medical science, you have an infection, you have fever, you take some antibiotic or whatever the doctor prescribes, and in 5 days your fever comes down and you are back to normal. In behavioral sciences, nothing happens in 5 days. Nothing happens in 5 weeks. But in 5 months, I can assure you, you will definitely see the change. And as I keep on reminding you, any of these topics which I take up and which I discuss with you all, once you make that effort, you're consistent with your efforts, and you start seeing the change coming in. It is a change for life. The doctor's medicine works only for that infection. You can again get back an infection a few months or a few years later. But these changes which we are discussing and which I am trying to, you know, spread out and give to you in a very simple and a very rational way of life. The great advantage is, though it is slow, though it takes time, it has a permanent effect. You can actually enjoy the benefits of that lifelong. And equally important, once you have done it, it becomes easier for you to teach it to others. Once you know how to overcome guilt, you recall and say, yes, once upon a time, I used to feel very guilty. People used to say these things and I used to break down. I used to cry. I used to feel ashamed. But now that I have overcome it and I know that it is possible and I have done it for myself, I can now teach it to anybody who is willing, who is open, and who approaches me. So you can spread this word. You can do so much good to society and to people around you. I'm only one person talking to a few of you, but each one of you can spread this message and make life much, much more comfortable, much, much more ethical, and much, much more, you know, in harmony with everybody around you, almost everybody. So keep that in mind. Yes. We have one more. Nice topic, which will definitely help us grow mentally strong. Thank you so much. Yes, you're right. We do have to take up these things, take it seriously, practice it, and you will see those results. Okay. So with that, allow me to sign off, and I will be meeting you again next Saturday. Anis will put on the topic, which is competition and competitors in life. I purposely put that, if you see. When we say competition, I want you also to be aware of who are your competitors. There are, you know, ethical competitors. There are unethical competitors also. So when you have to face competition, be aware of who are your competitors, what they can do to you, what you can do to prevent yourself, and face competition in a positive manner and continue doing whatever you want. So that is going to be our topic on 11th of May at 2 o'clock, as always. And I shall be with you at that time. Till then, have a nice time. Thank you. Bye-bye.
At home only. Okay, we won't go anywhere. Bye. Oh my god, you know the guy was texting me yesterday? He said he wants to meet.
Yeah.
You sound like you're jealous.
Dude, you just met him yesterday.
So? You're just jealous that he didn't text you first. This has been happening.
Excuse me.
You just can't stand the fact that I'm prettier than you or guys can like me more than you.
I'm just looking out for
you. I don't care what you have to say. I am going to go out with him.
Whatever you want.
Hi girls.
Hi.
How was your day? You people had good time?
Yes, auntie.
You said you people wanted to be at home.
Yes. We were watching a movie to get good. I have lots of work at kitchen.
She could have easily lied about me. But she did not. Even after I screamed at her so much. I shouldn't have screamed at her so much.